are. Worship Him, worship Him. Come on, just worship the King. Worship the King. Come on, lift your hands. Glory to God. Glory.
Let's give the praise team a hand clap. Amen. Amen. You all can come down. Amen. Thank you. This is the new normal, and we're trying to get used to everything, but we thank you for being here. And right now, let me just give you just a few announcements. Don't forget that we just started back. This is Father's Day. Once again, I want to say happy Father's Day to all of our men that are here and to those that are watching by live stream. So, praise the Lord. Don't forget, on Tuesday, we have prayer time every Tuesday on the phone by conference call. And if you would want more information, please call the church Monday through Thursday from 11 to 4 o'clock, 4:30. And you can get that information on how to join us in prayer. We've been having some great times in prayer. That prayer starts at 7 Eastern time and ends at 7:30. We've got people from other states and that are joining us, and we've just been having a great time with that. And then don't forget our online Food for Thought Bible study. That's continued to be online, and that's every Wednesday, and that starts at 7 o'clock. You can watch it on Facebook, or you can watch it on YouTube, and we do send links out, so you can do that. And then this morning, we want to get ready to take our tithes and our offerings. And before we do that, I want to have a quick prayer for Tierra. Tierra is one of our leaders. She's over Chosen and the other team. And she's in the hospital, Divine Destiny. And she's in the hospital. She has an infection, and she's in a lot of pain. So can we just pray for her? Lord, we thank you for your love, your mercy, and your grace. We thank you, Lord, that you love Tierra. And I know, Lord, that even though she was in pain up until Friday and still in some pain, we know that you are the great provider. You are the great healer. And God, she had already purposed in her mind if she was going to be here. But Lord, you knew, God, what was going to happen. And I know that you love Tierra. And I ask that you would meet Tierra at the very point of her need. I ask that you would do something supernatural in her life. God, right now, touch her body, touch her mind. Lord, bless this service today. And just do everything that's said and done. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. All right. You know, with the new normal, if you need to pay your tithes, most people, 90% of the people, have been paying their tithes online. They've been paying their tithes online. So if you want to pay your tithes online, you can go to Cash App if you have a Cash App account. And in Cash App, you can type the $ the house of peace for you. The $ the house of peace for you. And if you would see that symbol right there, that will let you know that's our church. So if you are here today and you want to do that, you want to make a donation, you can. Or you can go to thehouseofpeaceforyou.org. That's our website. And you can pay through PayPal. You can pay through PayPal. You can do that. Or if you want to mail a check, you can make it out to the House of Peace. And you can go and you can put it in the mailbox, and you can, it's P.O. Box 52393, Jacksonville, Florida, 32201. One more time. P.O. Box 52393, Jacksonville, Florida, 32201. All right. I ain't did that in a long time, so I have to get used to it. Or if you want to bring it by the church Monday through Thursday, we're here Monday through Thursday from 11 to 4:30. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your love, your mercy, and your grace. Thank you for everything that you do. I pray, Lord, that you would just bless this time, bless the tithes. I just pray that people would give online. I pray, Lord, that you would just make sure that every need is met. Lord, you promised to meet our needs. And if we give, it shall be given back to us of good measures, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give unto our bosom. So, once again, God, just be with us and just strengthen and encourage us and just work out each and everything the way that it need to be. In Jesus' name, amen. You can give.
My God will supply every one of my voice. What I'm not need. I'm not gonna worry.
Hey.
Praise the Lord. Amen. We are getting ready for the Word of God. I am so excited. This is the first time in what, almost 4 months that I've been able to preach live. Everything has been pre-recorded, but now I get a chance to preach before an audience. So I'm so excited. Once again, we want to wish all the men a happy Father's Day. Come on, let's give them a hand clap. Amen. Thank you all. Amen. As you can see that we have a different set now. I don't use the platform, the podium, and there's some other things that, you know, that we are doing and we're trying to get better at in the new normal. Everybody say new normal.
New normal.
New normal. Yes. All right. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for an opportunity to present your word. And I ask, Lord, that as I present your word, I will present it with boldness, power, great authority. I pray that this word would minister not only to those that are here, but to those that are watching by live stream. I pray, Lord, that your anointing would destroy yokes. And Lord, you would bring everything back to my remembrance. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Amen. How many of you ready? You ready? All right. In this new normal that has changed a lot of things that we do differently now, I want to do something differently in the way that I present the Word of God to you today. Now, I want to entitle this anointed message, and I know that you're used to me bringing things up on the screen, but this is something different since this is our first time going live, so I won't have too much on the screen. But the title of my anointed message today is, Let's Not Forget About Our Father's Business. Let me say it again. Let's not forget about our Father's business. Now, I want y'all to think about this. When we join the family of God, we become a part of a huge network of believers around the world. But even more importantly than that, we become sons and daughters of God. And when we become his sons and daughters, he begins to take up our cause. Everybody say, God takes up my cause. Yes, he takes up our cause. Come on, give me some thumbs up online if you can. Hallelujah. He takes up our cause. As a matter of fact, in the book of Lamentations, chapter 3, verse 58, it says this. You have taken up my cause, O Lord. Hallelujah. You have redeemed my life. And like it says in this verse, God takes up our what? Our cause, whatever it is. Hallelujah. And he redeems our life. I thank God for salvation. I thank God that he didn't allow me to die in my sin. I thank God for Jesus. I thank God for the blood of Jesus. I thank God that his blood washed my sins away. I thank God that I have a new way of living. I'm new in Christ. My name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and I'm so excited about that. But not only has he redeemed us, not only that, but God promises to meet all of our needs. That's right. He promises to meet all our need. He knows our every need. Even before we asked him for it, he is good and gracious to provide for us all that we need so that we can live a life for his glory and his pleasure. Amen? Isn't it amazing that God, who reigns over all the earth, attends to our needs? You know, he knows every one of your needs. He knows, let me say it again, he knows every one of your need. Even before we asked him for it, he knows what your need is. He knows what your physical needs are, your emotional needs, your relational needs, your financial needs, your social needs, even in our health. Hallelujah. God is right there for us. Or you know what? I can, or just getting through difficult times. Hallelujah. God knows how to get us through difficult times. He orders our steps and ways we should go. He protects us from seen and unseen danger. I don't know how many times I might have left my front door open and we was in the house at night sleeping or certain other things and we forgot to. Then I get up the next day, I'm like, oh my God, somebody could have came in and did something to us. But he protects us, as I said, from seen and unseen danger. You know, I can go on and on. How many of you know he is good and gracious to provide for us all that we need so that we can live a life for his glory, and I got to say it again, and for his pleasure. You know, it's amazing that God, who reigns over all the earth, like I said, he attends to all of our needs. You know, this is one of my favorite scriptures in Psalms chapter 37, verse 25. It says, I was young and now I'm old, and yet I have never seen the righteous, hallelujah, hallelujah, begging bread. Isn't that something? God knows, hallelujah, where we are. He knows where we are. You see, it's good to know that if God is for us, then who can be against us? Hallelujah. This thought brings to me much hope, and I know it changes my own perspective, especially when I'm feeling discouraged or depressed or don't even know what's going to happen next, especially with this pandemic and even the racial tensions that's going on in our country right now. But just like God takes care of our cause, we need to take up our Heavenly Father's cause. Okay? God does so much for us, but you know, that just can't be a one-sided story. It's got to be given and taken. We both got to do. God does so much for us. Even when we don't do a lot, he does so much for us. And so we need to be taking up our Heavenly Father's cause. Now, I want you to ask yourself this question. Have you really been doing the things that God requires of you during this pandemic? I want you to think about that, because I'm going to ask it again. Have you really been doing the things that God requires of you during this pandemic? Have you really been about the Father's business? Because if he is really Lord of your life, then you will want your life to mirror his. You will want what he wants. Do as he does. Go as he goes. Give as he gives. And live as he lives. You know, Jesus said this in my opening text of Luke chapter 2, verse 49. He says, I must be about my Father's business. Let me say it again. This is Jesus at 12 years old. I must be about my Father's business. Now, the word conveys a strong divine connection. I must be about my Father's vision. You see, this is not an option. This is my life, my soul, my all. That's how we ought to live. So once again, I want to ask you, are you about your Father's business? How is that reflected in your prayer life? How is that reflected in your reading and studying God's word daily? How is that reflected in your giving? How is that reflected in you reaching those who are unchurched? Let me ask you something. When is the last time you shared the gospel with somebody? When is the last time you told somebody about Jesus? You know, when is the last time did you do that? Are you about the Father's business? I have to keep asking that. Are you about the Father's business? How much time do you spend in the average week doing the things for yourself? And how much time do you doing things for the Father? Think about that. 24 hours in the day. Where do you spend most of your time? We know we got to sleep. That's probably 6 to 8 hours, so you can't do nothing about that. You know, if you're working, that's another 8 hours, some 10 or 12. But what are you doing with the rest of that time? What are you doing with that rest of the time? What are you doing? You see, when you think about it, we have TV time for most people. We got social media. Then we do recreational things. Then we may lounge around the house, and with this pandemic, you know, there are a lot of other things, you know, that we do, and we may not be able to get out like we do. But I want to ask you, okay, those are things that we normally do. But how much time are we cracking the Bible open and actually studying God's word? How much time are we doing? How much time did you spend reading the word last week? Did you do it every day? You need to ask yourself that. Let me ask you this. How many of you have been sending a text or calling someone to encourage them? You know, it's amazing how so many people are not, you know, if I'm your brother or if you're my sister, we need to be encouraging one another. You know, the scripture says this, each of you should not look towards your own interests, but the interests of others. And if you don't text, you can call somebody. You know, there are times that I have called people and they said, I needed that. You know, and it might have been in another city or it might have been in another state. And they said, man, you called at the right time. I needed that. So how much time are you sending texts or calling someone to encourage them? Are you about your Father's business? The question is not just for adults. Listen to me. The question is not just for adults. The question is for children and young adults too. Are you about your Father's business? J.C. Ryle said this, let them remember that if you are old enough to do wrong, you are also old enough to do right. And if able to read storybooks and to talk, you are also able to read your Bible and pray. You see, we need to be about the Father's business. Would you say that with me? Lord, help me to be about your business. Now, we live in a world full of distractions. Dictionary.com defines distractions as that which distracts, divides our attention, or prevents us from concentration or concentrating. Distractions can be annoying, time-consuming, and even dangerous. Now, look at it, annoying. You're trying to read something, and that little gnat or that fly is buzzing around your ear. That's annoying, isn't it? Or think about time-consuming things. You sit down at the computer, and you're determined that you're going to start that project, and the phone starts ringing. Now, all of a sudden, guess what? You're distracted. Okay? Or think about something that can happen very dangerous that distracts us. You're driving on the freeway, and all of a sudden, your text alert goes off. Hello? And what do? You're trying to what? Read your text while you're driving. I told my daughter the other day, because I see a lot of teenagers and a lot of young adults when they're driving, they're trying to drive and text. And I said, baby, the Lord spoke to me and told me to tell you, do not text and drive. I said, thank God that now on your phone, you can do an audible text. You can do an audible text. So I say, if you're going to be driving, do an audible text where you don't have to take your hand off the steering wheel. And most cars have this thing. So I can say, text Brother Roosevelt. And they say, what do you want to say to Brother Roosevelt? Hello, Brother Roosevelt, just checking on you. Love you. This is an audible text. Amen. And then they say, do you want to send it? I can send it. But that is very dangerous. Think about teenagers or think about adults that they took their eye off the road just for a minute or second, and then, bam, they hit something. You see, all of these things are dividing our attention and preventing concentration. You know, a documentary recently showed college students trying to multitask while being monitored by researchers. Now, the study showed that we humans beings can really only focus on one thing at a time. Okay, you say, wait a minute, I multitask. Well, let me show you what I mean. We think we're doing things simultaneously, but we're not. We're not. What we can do is switch our attention from task to task extremely quickly. Okay? So anything that takes us away from our main goal is a distraction, okay? Anything that takes you away from your main goal is a distraction. Maybe you heard the term rabbit trails. Anybody heard rabbit trails? Maybe some of y'all, the younger, you don't understand that. But a rabbit trail is anything that takes us off the main road. Let's say we go out into the woods to try to take a photo of a deer, okay? So we're looking for a deer, but we get so distracted by the rabbit trails that we never get to the deer because we're looking for everything else. You ever been on your way, you know, to do something, and then all of a sudden something distracted you, and then you say, I do that, you know, at age 58. I'd be like, oh, now, why was I going this way? I just get so distracted because something distracts me. Now, hence, because we take these rabbit trails and we get distracted, hence we come back with nothing. We didn't even get a picture because we got distracted. Now, if there are natural distractions, there are also spiritual distractions. They are one of the enemy's most effective weapons against a believer. You know, he loves to get us out on a rabbit trail. He wants to get you from distracted from doing what God would have you to do. You see, there seems to be a trend for some believers right now. They are just so focused on this pandemic that's going on right now that they are really not about the Father's business. And I talk to a lot of people. This has been going on for 4 months now. It's really been going on longer than this, but we just really started discovering what we needed to do in practicing social distance. But because of this pandemic, people are just so, they're just not focused. They're just really not focused at all. You see, is that really God's will for us? I mean, we know during this pandemic, we're still eating. We're still sleeping. We're still watching TV. Some of us, we're still working, or if we have to work from home, we're still going to the grocery store. We're still going to the doctor's office. None of those things change. Yes, a lot of other things change, but in this pandemic, are we about the Father's business? Is that really God's will for us? Do you know the best way to find all the sand spurs in your carpet? You know what the sand spurs are. We used to call them cuckabugs. You know the things when you walk in and those things stick to you and y'all call them, but they're really sand spurs. Okay, now, so do you know the best way to find a sand spur if it's in your carpet? The answer is simple. Take off your shoes and start walking. And you'll find every one of them. As a matter of fact, you'll be like, oh, ooh, ah, 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 ah. Now, in my opening text of Luke chapter 2, verses 41 through 52, we have the story of the 12-year-old Jesus who was left behind in Jerusalem after the Passover feast. His parents assumed he was with the company because when they traveled in large groups. And you just not wasn't necessarily, you know, with your family. You could have been with some of the neighbors, little boys and kids. But they assumed that he was with the company, the group of relatives and friends that they were traveling together. Now, at the end of the day of traveling, they didn't find him. So they turned around and they went back to Jerusalem. Now, imagine their fright and their concern, not knowing what had become of him. What happened next is would go beyond our, it's just remarkable. But I just want to think about you. Think about your child. You know, you're in the store, and then all of a sudden you get detached from your child. And with all of this stuff going on, these child predators and everything, all of a sudden you're going berserk. You're going crazy. So I can imagine how Joseph and Mary felt. But when Joseph and Mary went back, and they looked all over for him. When they found Jesus, I want to ask y'all a question. Was he playing in Jerusalem with his friends? Did they find him distraught that he had been left by his friends? Oh, my mom, oh, my dad. You know, have you ever seen parents, some little child get lost? I want my mom. I want my mom. I want my daddy. Did we find him like that? No. Did they find him on the road from Jerusalem to Nazareth trying to catch up with them? No, he didn't. He wasn't saying, oh my God, I got left by my mom and daddy. I gotta go down this road and I gotta find them. I gotta try to catch up with them. Not at all. What had he been doing for the past 3 days? It's been 3 days. For a 12-year-old, Brother Roosevelt. It's been 3 days, Sister Penny. What had he been doing for those past 3 days? He had spent his time in the temple, the house of God, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. This is what it said in Luke chapter 2, verse 46. It said, after 3 days, they found him in the temple court, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Wow. Now watch this. Mary is both amazed and a little kind of perturbed with Jesus and worried that he had caused her and Joseph, okay? Can you imagine? You know, you're in a panic, your child is lost, and then when you find him, you'd be like, why did you leave me like that? Why did you do that? You know, you're glad, but all of a sudden now you're mad. And Mary and Joseph kind of had to, Jesus, you knew that we had to leave at this time. Why did you do this? But the 12-year-old Jesus is amazed at his parents. He's amazed at them. Like, and this is what he asked them. He says this in 249, Luke 249. He says, why is it that you sought me? In other words, why are you looking for me? Okay, he understood his purpose, April. He said, why are you looking for me? He said, didn't you know that I must be about my father's business? You hear that, St. Clair? He said, mom and dad, yeah, y'all my earthly parents, but you got to remember who I am. Okay, didn't you know that I was about my father's business? Now, I'm absolutely amazed at Jesus' response to his parents. Here is a 12-year-old boy who for 3 days hasn't been concerned about being left behind, nor has he been concerned about the typical things that 12-year-old boys are concerned with, like playing video games or doing social media or talking on the phone or texting. He wasn't concerned about none of those things. Rather, He's being concerned about his father's business. 12 years old. Now, what business was that? Spiritual matters. Spiritual matters. You see, the study of God's word, learning what his personal responsibility was as a servant of God. He was concerned about his mission and what God had called him to do. He knew that it was more important to be about his father's business. He understood that. He knew that I got to be about my father's business. God put me here on earth with a purpose. And I want to say to you that's listening, and I want to say to you that are here, God put you here on earth for a purpose. Now, how many 12-year-olds today, even those who are being reared by godly parents, have the same spiritual maturity? Now, I dare not say not many. That's not an indictment of our young people or their parents. But this story does provide some lessons for all of us, young people and parents alike. First and foremost, we need to understand what is the most important thing in your life right now. What is the most important thing? Think about it. If you had only 3 days to live, or a week to live, or a month to live, all of a sudden, you know, things take on a different perspective. What would be important to you then? Would your car be important to you? Would your money be important to you? You would be thinking, if you know that there's a heaven and a hell, and you know that you're getting ready to leave this earth, you know, you would be trying to make sure that everything is all right. As a matter of fact, you know, I see this all the time. When somebody's getting ready to go into surgery for a life and death situation, what happens with them, they say, well, Pastor, I just want to make sure that I'm straight. You know, they say, Rev, I just want to make sure I'm straight. So would you pray with me? I just want to make sure. See, they want to make sure that everything is all right. You see, there are so many good things about our life, blessings and privileges that we have that we can enjoy. We have friends. We have families that we can spend time with. We watch TV. We play games. We go places to visit, some toys to play with. You know, I have toys. They're just expensive toys. They're just adore toys. So we are, you know, we have jobs. School is out, but before that, you have school work to finish. But in the grand scheme of things, none of that really matters. It's important, but what's most important is your father's business. You see, absolutely nothing should come before being about our father's business. This doesn't mean that we can't spend time, we can't spend our time with those fun aspects of life, okay? It doesn't mean that. That's not what I'm saying. How can I show concern for my father's business? Simply this, God put you here on earth for a purpose. And I want to talk about one of those purposes today. The Bible says we are the light and salt of the earth. Okay? We are the light and we are the salt of the earth. And out there, we are the light and salt of the earth. And out there, we need to be ministering to people, okay? I know that we're doing social distancing, and I'm not talking about, you know, there are different ways that we can minister to people. You can do it through a text. You can do it through a phone call. You can do it through, you know, you can do it through a lot of ways that you minister to people. When I think about Sinclair, every day he goes to check on his mother. Every day, there's not a single day that I don't think he goes by that he goes to check on his mother. Now, what if he just stopped doing that and said, well, you know, this pandemic is happening and, you know, she's an older and she's more susceptible. No, hey, that's my response. I want to check on my mother. So he has that type of relationship with his mother. You understand? So, but we ought to be the light of the world, okay? We need to be ministering to people. Like I said, it is surprising how many people, as the pastor, I said, wow, it's been 3 months. You haven't sent me a text. You haven't called me. You haven't checked on me. You haven't asked if I'm doing all right. I'm like, wow. And then I'm texting some people and they won't even answer. I'm just checking. I'm not asking you to do anything, but I'm just saying is, you know, the Bible says what I said, each of you should not look towards your own interests, but the interests of others. You see, there are people who have needs. And I'm going to tell you that I've been calling people and I've been finding out what their needs are. And if I can meet their needs, I'm going to do it. If God gives me something, I'm going to make sure that I do it. If I have to cash app to it, if I have to send them a check in the mail, I'm making sure. There are a lot of people that are hurting. Do you know there have been people that have stuck up in the house for the past, for the past 4 months? And some of those people are depressed. Some of those people are suicidal. Some of those people are in families where women or men are being physically or sexually abused. It's a lot of things that are going on. People are hurting. People are hurting. Do you hear me? People are hurting. And you know what? During this time, this is when we need to let people see Jesus through our words and deeds. Now, I notice as a church, we may not be able to do a lot of things, but, you know, I appreciate those churches that have been giving groceries out. You know, they have volunteers that come, and that's all, they don't have to come in contact with the person. You just drive up, and you put the groceries in their car. Pastor Daryl Geddes, his church is 5 blocks away from where George Floyd passed away, was murdered, and even though everything is tore up, but let me tell you something, God is using that church in a very tremendous way because they feed people, I mean give groceries, because guess what? There's no grocery stores there. There's nothing, and they're feeding people. And you know, the minute that they took up that cause of feeding the community, You know what's happening? You know what's happening? Praise God. People are coming out of the woodworks. A man walked up to him and said, I know you're only going to be doing this for a month, but this church, and they said, here's $10,000 so you can keep doing what you're doing. Okay? He has had hundreds of volunteers come from all over the city. They're saying, how can we help you? And they have tons of food where they're feeding people and meeting people's needs. Let me tell you something. We can get so caught up in where we are that we forget that we're supposed to be salt and light. We can get so caught up in our own little world and doing what we need to do, take care of our family, which is our first responsibility, but we forget that there are people in our church. There are people that are your friends and your co-workers. There are people that are wondering. This is the greatest time to present the plan of salvation to people, to talk to people about the Lord. We need to be about the Father's business. Now you say, what is so different about what you're doing? Because I don't see nothing different. Well, this is what the Lord gave me. We're going to go to a video. I did a video interview with one of our members. And what she said is right on. And this is where most people are that's in the church. And so right now, would you hit those lights over there? We're going to look at this video. And then I'm going to come back. But this video is 31 minutes. And I want you to pay very close attention. This is a very powerful video. Would you take that backlight too back there? See the one right there? This is a very powerful video. And so, Keisha, are you ready? Amen. So for the next 31 minutes, I just need you to give me your attention. It probably is not on the, the dual screen. Yeah, there we go. There you go. All right. So this is very powerful. Very emotional, too. So would you mute me, Tracy?
And this is something that I don't normally do, but something unique and happened the other day. I think it was last Thursday. I was up really late, about 1 o'clock in the morning. And the Lord just said, I just need you to start praying for people. And so I began to pray for people. And one of the persons that I was praying for was Sister Linda Williams right here. And I just felt a deep, it's just hard to describe that my prayer time that I had with God. And so probably, I think it was on Friday or Thursday. What day did I talk to you? Was it Saturday?
Saturday,
I talked to Sister Linda, and she told me something that happened to her that is so phenomenal. And when she told me about it, I felt like I needed to record this and allow other people to hear it. She received a letter, an email from the chaplain at her job. And I want to read this, and then we're going to get into what happened. This is what it says. And I'm not going to probably use names in here, but it says this. When a person we have worked with and have come to know dies, many questions are raised and sorrow is experienced. He says that when he spoke to the wife of the deceased officer, that even in her sorrow, she was filled with great hope and peace. She told me that prior to her husband's diagnosis, that he didn't have a relationship with God. But through this, he had become a believer. Her peace is that she knows that she has not lost him, or when something is lost, you do not know where it is at. She knows where he is because of his faith and her faith. Faith is an important thing. The Apostle Paul said this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 19. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. Then the chaplain goes on to say, my translation is, if this is all there is, if this is as good as it gets, we're all miserable. Christ has something much better for us. Faith reminds us that there are things that happen that we do not understand and we do not like, but God has a plan and a purpose, and there's something much better ahead of us if we have faith. Now, the correctional officer that's now deceased had told his wife that he wanted Miss Williams to sing Amazing Grace to him as he transitioned from this world to heaven. She was blessed to be able to do that. The last verse of that song says, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. In reality, the deceased's life has not ended, but has only just begun. His suffering is over, and he is in a place where there is no more tears, sorrow, or suffering. Faith reminds us that we might not always get it, but that God always got it. So, when you were telling me about this story, man, I was so intrigued about how this came about. Mm-hmm. And I really just felt like that there are going to be hundreds, literally thousands of people out there that's going to need to hear this, because, you know, there's just so much going on in our society, and we get so busy about our lives and doing what we need to do that we forget, you know, there are others that are in need, and you happen to be there. Mm-hmm. So can you just, you know, just share the story. Tell you know, what was going on, how it came to be.
Okay. I was in Zooming for court. I had a big calendar that day, and one of my coworkers knocked on the door, came in. I had the speaker mute, so the judges and attorneys couldn't hear me. So she said, my coworker's wife wanted me to call her. And I said, okay. And I said, I can't call her now because I'm in court. So she put the sticker note next to my laptop. So while I was still Zooming for court, I kept looking at the number, mm-hmm. looking at the officer's wife's number. And I'm like, oh, I said, I can't call right now. So I looked at it about two or three times, and about the last time if I looked at it, the Holy Spirit would not allow me to continue to zoom in with court. I just had to call her. So I muted everything, the speaker, I muted the video for they won't see me. So I got up from my desk and I went around my desk and called her. And I, when she answered the phone, I said, hey, this is Linda Williams. And she was crying. She was crying so much. So I couldn't really understand her because they from Honduras and the language is kind of hard to understand. Mm-hmm. So she was telling me, I heard her say he was in intensive care. She took him back to the hospital that Wednesday night, intensive care.
What was his prognosis? Why was he in the hospital?
He had cancer in the brain. Mm. So I just, she said, I thought she telling me, I said, okay, I'm so sorry to hear that. And I thought she was telling me to pray. So I just start praying. And as soon mm-hmm. as I finished praying, I said, okay, let him know that, you know, we thinking and we praying for him. And, you know, and we know what the doctor had said when he had left work, that he only had 6 months to live, but he outlived those 6 months mm-hmm. over a year and a half. Mm-hmm. So I let her know that, you know, still, she said, no, I need you to sing Amazing Grace. I said, and I'm still listening to
the
my
court
uh-huh. going on. I'm like, and not one time they needed me. So I'm like, you want me to sing? She said, Amazing Grace, sing. He's transitioned. I said, what? Mm. So
wow.
I start singing Amazing Grace. I start singing the song, and all of a sudden I just heard the breathing.
Mm. Take your time.
I heard the breathing. He was taking his last breath, but he,
okay, go ahead.
I kept singing a song. And when I finished singing the song, I told her that we love him. And she kept saying, She said, Marco told me when, before he died, to please call Linda Williams, and tell her to sing Amazing Grace. And I said, what? And just the thought, he thought of me.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know where he told her that. It was an honor and it was a privilege to do that. But it just caught me off guard. And not one time. I can hear the judges, I can hear the attorney, not one time they needed me. And now God, he allowed that time.
Yeah.
He allowed that time.
For you to be able to do that.
To be able to do that.
Now, you know, let me ask you the question, because, you know, so many times we get caught up into our lives and the things we got to do, and we know that we have to render to Caesar what's Caesar. Mm-hmm. But there are times that God will interrupt our lives and says, there's something bigger and greater than what you're doing right now.
Right.
And if you be obedient to me, I'll take care of the judge and I'll take care of what's going on there.
Yes.
And he took care
yeah, he
of that,
did.
Right? You
he
didn't
did.
You didn't violate anything. They didn't have to ask you any questions.
No,
but
did.
God knew that
yeah.
That man needed you at that time in his dying hour.
Yes.
And, you know, yes. I've been preaching a lot here lately and just saying, you know, a lot of people have become complacent. A lot of things have become about them. But tell me, what have you learned from this? Because, and then there's another question I want to ask you, but what have you learned from this?
Like I said, it took me, I was total lost with this. But I realized at that time how God works. I realized that it wasn't about me at that particular time. It wasn't about me. Mm-hmm. It was about someone needed something because they was, you know, passing on.
Right.
But I know it was his way of getting my attention.
Your attention. Mm-hmm. I'll explain that.
Because I mean, I don't know what nobody else, but I know through this
pandemic,
and being gone for like 3 months from out of church, it's a big difference. It's like lackadaisical or like don't wanna, you know, not say I don't wanna serve God no more. Or just I was just doing me.
Right.
I was doing me.
That's come on.
I was
be
just
honest
doing me.
About
I've just been working. Been working, going home, working, doing me, didn't give God the time. And so I realized, okay, I realized that I was just giving God time while I'm in church. And because I was obligated. So, you know, and I love God. And so, I mean, he had to get a hold of me at that point of time just to do that and let me know that he's still here and he's still God and that I can't put nothing before him. And if I wasn't obedient to the Spirit,
yes,
then don't tell him what you know where he what. But I know he's in a better place. But I just felt in my spirit I've done something that God called me to do.
Right.
So and that was a hard task. And I done sung to many funerals, but doing something like this and get God getting a hold of me like that and just and it just stuck with me and it's still I can't. It's still not a day go by that I don't think about this, that what happened and how now I just realized that I need to do more better.
You got to do better for the Lord.
For the Lord.
You got to be sensitive to Him.
Sensitive to the Spirit.
You just can't get into your own stuff.
And that's what I've been doing. It just, you know, it's just been lazy.
Yeah.
Laziness. Yeah. So I'm like, you know, I listen to, you know, the service on Sundays, but it's a big difference.
Yeah. Well let me ask you something. What do you think would have happened if you hadn't done what the Spirit of the Lord told you to do, and then you found out later that he was taking his last dying breath, and you wasn't on the phone to bring comfort, so as he made his transition, how do you think you would have felt?
Oh, I know. I would have been miserable. I know I would have been, because during that time, looking at that sticky note where, with the wife's name on it and her telephone number, I kept saying, she's just going to have to wait. I'm being honest.
Come on. That's right. That's what we do,
this
right?
This is my job.
This is my job.
This is my job. And you know, I can't do this on my job.
Right.
You know, so but the Holy Spirit would not allow me to say it's not about you, Linda.
Right. There you go.
It wasn't about me. So that's what I know. That's why I know. That's why I know God is real. Mm-hmm. And I just can't believe how things just keep, how he do things in a miraculous way. So to me, that was an eye-opener for me.
Yes.
That I know that I cannot, you know, worry about what my surroundings and what I do. Uh-huh. And I can't just say, oh, I have to do this, do that. I need to get about God's business.
That's
right. I need to do God's work because at this time of this pandemic, it's a wake-up call for many of us. So you know, and I just think it was an honor and privilege
for
me to do that.
Now that this has happened, so many people have heard about this on your job, and now people are calling you and Just give some things about what's happening.
Yeah, and it's overwhelming for them. They're like, you know, and they're feeling, you know, not sorry for me, but they're just feeling the grief, and they can feel that. They said, wow, for you to have to went through that. And they said, wow, Linda, you. And they kept saying, "Honor, honor, and proof that it had been for you." I said, "Yes," but it, I think what was, I didn't know half of my, some of my coworkers, they hurt me.
Uh-huh.
You know, because my door was closed, they hurt me, so I went out crying, and you know, they grabbed me. But I think it changed some people, because they were like, "Wow," something. Like, "Oh, you gonna sing Amazing Grace for me?" So you know, some probably like, you know, but you know, as it gets to make you smile and all that and stuff. But you know, I realized, hey, this is real.
This is real.
This
That's
is
right.
real.
Absolutely
this is
real.
No joke. This is real. And
not only are you affecting his life, but you affected so many other people's lives. And so many times we can get so busy that we miss God. And when we miss God, it not only affects us, but it affects other people.
Exactly.
Now this is probably gonna open the door for you to be able to talk to a lot of people who may not be in right standing with God, or who may be in a backsliding state, and they will know, because you were bold enough, you know, when you were telling them that something, you were finna say something.
Yeah, I was finna say something. I, you know how you so be careful what you say at work, but I was getting ready to say the word something. And then I was like, no, I am not going to put God on that line, because he's not a something. And I learned that many, many years ago. No, he's the spirit. He's the spirit, Holy Spirit. So I did not tell my co-worker something. I said, the spirit led me. The spirit told me to call this woman. The spirit told me. And I said, no, I would never put him as a something. Never. So, they understood what I meant when I said that. So.
Right.
But sometimes I just try to, you know, be careful what you say,
because
you don't know everybody's different, you know. So I just had to say.
But, you know, this reminds me, when you was just talking, reminds me with Esther. You know, Esther had a chance to save her people. And when her people's life was on the line, you know, and her... her cousin, which was like a father to her, you know, he said, "You need to go in and talk to the king." And she was like, "No, I can't talk to the king, because he hadn't called me, and there's a decree that has been written that if you go in and talk to the king, and if he doesn't extend his scepter to you, then you will be put to death."
Right.
And then, you know, her cousin just told her, "Don't think just because you're in the palace, or just because you're married to the king, that you're going to escape this." And he says, "Maybe God has brought you to the throne for such a time as this." And so sometimes we have to lay things on the line, because there is a greater purpose. There's something bigger than us.
Right.
And, you know, I believe that many lives are going to be touched and changed.
Yeah.
You know, because you were able, you know, to do this. And it's so important. I just want to say to people, it is so important that you get close to God, stay in tune with his voice, and not get so busy, not get so caught up.
Yes.
You know, because I know that for the past 2 weeks with these race riots and everything going on, I'm having all of these people of influence. I mean, big church, small church, parachurch ministries that are calling me and saying, "Can you come?" And you know, I'm so caught up in what I'm doing in the church. And the Lord said, no, son, you don't understand. This is bigger than you. And you've got to get out of yourself. And if you get out of yourself, I'll work out everything else. Now, I know that... there's been some difficult times in your life, and at times you've been stressed and, you know, just crying and a lot of things, but how, because you were obedient to God, what did God has kind of rejuvenated you about some things of how you see life. Can you just talk about that just a little bit?
Yes, I know. I have things in my life that's not in order, or just chaos, where you want to use the word chaos. So, but I, within that time period, after that happened with me, it's a different light now. It's a different atmosphere. It's a different way I feel now. I know that God's still there. I know he still cares for me. I know he still loves me. And if, as long as I continue to keep that faith, continue to, no matter how things look in my life, then I know he's still yet God. Mm-hmm. He's still going to take care of me. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to go without. Mm-hmm. He's still going to make me put that smile on my face. Mm-hmm. So I'm just overwhelmed. I'm overwhelmed with that. I'm so overwhelmed that I know that it may not look good mm-hmm. in some situations. Mm-hmm. But I know, yet he's still God. And I know he's going to fix that situation.
So what would you tell to the people in that church and others that's going to be watching it, what would you tell them that have gotten into a spirit of complacency and, you know, they just not about the Father's business? You know, I'm not saying that they don't love God. I'm not saying they don't serve God. But sometimes we can become so complacent and life becomes about us and we don't think, oh, man, this pandemic and this and that. But when God speaks, God knows what he's doing. He knows our beginning and our ending, and he's in our middle. And so when he's guiding us, we've got to be ready, or we can't be so busy and so caught up into ourselves that we miss God. So what would you say to people that are going through this and they're in a spirit of complacency or they're not doing spiritual things? What would you say to them?
All I can say is just encourage them. I know we all have got, like I said, a word, that favorite word, last of days ago. I encourage everyone, even myself. And I'm not going to sit here and say I'm not like you all, because I was doing the same. I got too comfortable mm-hmm. of not praising God, reading the word. I got too comfortable because mm-hmm. it was just, why should I have to do all that? You know, we don't have to go to church. And mm-hmm. So, but I encourage you that we cannot be too comfortable into God. We cannot do that.
We can't put him on the back burner.
We can't put him on the back burner. Yes.
Yeah, so because certain things about our life is going on. You still going to work.
I'm still going to work.
You're still doing other things.
I'm still doing everything.
But when it comes to God, it's been like, oh, God, you understand. We're in this pandemic.
Right.
You know,
right.
And so I think that's important. And I think that when we get about the Father's business, when we allow him to do what needs to be done in our life, then that's what it means when it says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these things. So then, but God begins to say, okay, you're about my business, mm-hmm. so now I'm going to be about your business, and I'm going to bring about some changes.
I'm going to bring about some changes.
Yes,
and I know change is coming. I know. I feel that in my spirit. I know change is coming. Every day when I get up, you know, it's sometimes, you know, how you said the enemy try to steer you the wrong way or have you not focusing, you know, you was preaching about that a lot, focusing, you know, on God and all that. So I just had to look at my mind and say, no, I got to continue to focus on God. Because if I continue to focus on God, he going to see I'm on the right pathway.
Yes.
So, and I'm going the right direction where he want me to go. So, and I know I can't go the wrong way.
Yeah.
So I'm just,
One more thing. Even after all of this happened, your coworker that passed, his wife called you, mm-hmm. and you helped walk her through some things that she is just so grateful.
Yeah, she was grateful.
To you.
Yeah, things worked out for her. For you know, a burial and all that. She called me. She actually texted me, asked me, did I know anyone? Because she really didn't know what to do. So mm-hmm. I gave her some good things and. God blessed her. Mm-hmm. He blessed her financially. Blessed her of having, you know, a service. You know, everything mm-hmm. is worked out.
Everything is working out.
Everything's working out.
And then God gave you a word for her, and we don't have to get personal. Mm-hmm. But the thing that you said to her the next day came to pass.
Yes, it did. Yes, and she was in the office crying and all that. And I just told her, no, God got this. And the next day she called, and God blessed. He just turned things around. God bless. So I know. I think all this. I don't know. I think during the learning time about her husband sick, she's been learning more about God and knowing that Jesus is real.
Yes, right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes. And you know, we're going to bring this to a close, but I really just felt like you needed to hear this testimony, because you may be going through some things right now. And we've been talking about a paradigm shift that God is trying to change mm-hmm. us. Yes. And sometimes he allows pressure to come in our lives to get our attention.
Yes.
And I really do believe that God is trying to get our attention. He's trying to get your attention. He's trying to say, you know, don't put me on the back burner. You know, make me first. Acknowledge me. Seek me. Make life about me, because when it's about me, the steps of a righteous man or a good man are ordered by the Lord.
And
sometimes we go through things we don't have to go through because we're trying to handle it on our own. And so that is important, you know, that we understand that when we're about the Father's business, it is so important that we be about His business. Now, I know that you were very nervous about doing this, but I, you know, I just felt a quickening in my spirit that we've got to do this. And lately here, God has been saying, okay, you can't just do the way you've been doing things. And this may just be a part of one of my sermons, you know, because they always hear the pastor saying that. And that's what they think. That's what the pastor is supposed to say. That's what the pastor is supposed to do. But then when they hear something like this, that you help a man transition by just singing a simple song. And then you helped his wife to work through some things that she needed to work through because she didn't know what to do. And she's so grateful. And then you touched a lot of people in your office. And now this gives you a chance to tell them about the Lord. Just give them a chance to tell them about your story, about how, you know, you were a religious person, you was in church, but you weren't, your heart wasn't right. But now, you know, God is, you know, God has worked out everything the way that He's supposed to. And so, you know, church, I always tell you this. Sometimes people get mad at me is because I'm always trying to tell them the truth. I'm always trying to push people to greatness. And they get mad at me. And then I simply tell them, you got to remember, I am not a man after the people's heart. I am a man after God's own heart. And when I do what God tells me to do, then I will be able to minister to people and push them to a place that they need to be. I know, you know, there are a lot of ladies in that church, they say, oh, pastor make me so mad, he make me so upset. But I can tell you one thing about that man. That man loves God, he prays, he's always got my best interest, he's always there for me. So, you know, it's all right. And I'm trying to tell you all, you know, get with the vision of the house. Get with God and watch Him do some great things in your life. So, Linda, I want you just to go ahead and just pray a prayer for people who may be watching this. Because, you know, there may be some people at home that is experiencing abuse or pain or grief or sorrow or financial difficulty. And they need to know that they are not by themselves. They need to know that. And even through everything that you're going through, God is just reminding you, I got this. You're not by yourself. Get close to me and watch me work. So would you just say a word of prayer?
Hallelujah. God, we just thank you this moment, this time, this hour, this minute. God, I ask you right now, God, to look upon your peoples, Father God, and I encourage, Father God, everyone, Father God, that's listening, everyone that's watching this, Father God, that they would know that you are God, that you're not leaving them, Father God, that you are blessed them abundantly and you're blessed them richly, Father God, that all they have to do is continue to trust in you, continue to keep the faith in you, knowing that you can do everything. You can do the impossible, God. Bless them financially, Father God. Bless them, Father God, the ones that's not working now, that lost their jobs, Father God. Bless them, Father God. Just have your way, Father God. Encourage your people, God. Encourage them. Let them know, Father God, that you are still here through all this pandemic. You are still here, God. Yes. And we thank you right now, God, for everything that you're going to do for your people, Father God. How you continue to lift them up, Father God. For the ones that's grieving, Father God. There's the ones that's being abused, Father God, mentally and physically, Father God. Touch them right now, Father God. We thank you, God. We thank you for your love. We thank you for caring, God. We know that there is no God before you, Father God. And we thank you for this day, God, this minute and this hour. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. If you would like to know more information about our church, something is going to come up on the screen, and you can get in contact with us. You know, we love people. As a matter of fact, our motto is, you matter to God, and you matter to us. And we want the House of Peace to be a place to belong in. Yeah. You've been there almost how long? 27 years. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a Jesus-filled day.
I want to say this pandemic has been very difficult for all of us. Very difficult, even for me. I probably worked more hours during this pandemic of not having church than I was before this pandemic. And I was telling my wife, as I'm getting ready to close, because we just got a few minutes here, I was telling my wife, I said, baby, I said, I know that...
Hello, my name is Pastor Michael Nelson.
I'm a very demanding person. Yes, I am. I'm a very demanding person because I grew up as the oldest child, and I had a lot of responsibility at 8 years old, catching the bus, taking my brothers and sisters to school, doing my sister's hair, picking them up, doing everything. And I didn't have nothing. But then I recognized that when I gave my heart to Jesus, I said, God, I want to give you my best. I want to give you my best. And when I give my best, I want to be able to give people my best. And I just got to be honest. I feel like I've given my best to this church. I've given my best. You can't say that you don't get a text or a phone call from me. You can't say that I don't keep you posted at everything. You can't say that if you call me that I have not been available. That's because I love people. And I tell my wife, I said, you know what? No matter whether people give me their best, I'm going to always give you my best. And I think that should be our desire. I think if you have learned something from this today, I pray that you would get out of yourself. I pray that if you've been complacent, you need to stop being complacent. And when you get up in the morning, you need to say, God, order my steps. If I got something planned and that's not what you want for me, God, if somebody calls me on the phone and they really needs me, or if I can do something, I got to step out of me. I got to step out of me, because when I step out of me, God will work things out. No way did I want to go to Deland, Florida for 2 weeks straight and be in a church service. But you know what? There are a lot of influential people there. And I'm speaking to people that can change things. I'm speaking to people all over. And I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, we've got to get out of ourselves. Because, I'm going to say this as I close. There's some things that's going to be starting to happen. And it may not have nothing to do with the pandemic, but there's some other things that are coming. You remember I told you back in December, you remember I told you to get close to God. Now I'm telling you there's some things that's going to be happening within this year. And in the coming year, there's going to be some things that's going to blow some people's mind. And if you're not close to God, you can miss it. But yet at the same time, what's going to happen, God is bringing revival. If you, I can give you the article, in revival, right where on the street that George Floyd was killed, people are now getting saved, people are getting healed, people are getting baptized right there in the street where he died. And God says there's going to come a mighty revival that's going to come and hit our city, that's going to hit the states, that's going to hit the whole world. But you know what? I would hate to be like I said last week, those five foolish virgins where we miss God. I'm not mad because people are not coming to church because everybody have their faith. But I'm just saying is, when you make decisions, don't make decisions out of fear. Make decisions out of, God, what are you trying to say to me? Because if you are doing what God wants you to do, he will always order your steps. So I want to pray. If you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior and Lord, would you just pray this prayer with me? And if you've just been in that complacent spirit, Linda's already prayed, so I'm just going to pray for those. You say, Lord, would you repeat me? Lord, I recognize that I'm a sinner and I have gone wrong. And you are real. And even in the midst of all this chaos, you are still God. And I'm a sinner and I need you in my life. Would you come into my heart? Be my Savior, Jesus. You died for my sins. You shed your blood for my sins. Come into my heart and do what needs to be done. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you. Remember, the house of peace is a place to belong, and you matter to God, and you matter to us. Have a Jesus-filled day.